Welcome to this panel discussion on the renaissance of regional food. I'm thrilled to have with me three passionate advocates of regional food, and I think we're in for an interesting discussion. Let me start by welcoming Thomas Zacharias. Previously the chef at the Bombay Canteen, Thomas began his culinary journey very early, inspired by his grandmother's home-cooked food. An alumnus of the prestigious Culinary Institute of America in New York, he has also worked at the three Michelin-starred Le Bernardin in NYC and traveled extensively across 18 states to immerse himself in the different elements of Indian home cooking. Welcome, Thomas.
Thank you so much, Primrose. Always good to see you.
Thank you. Next, let me introduce Chef Himanshu Taneja, currently Director of Culinary for South Asia, Marriott International. He has 20 years of experience under his chef's hat. He works on talent development and training, keeps a close eye on the pulse of market demands, and curates concepts that are both innovative and trend-setting to ensure that Marriott's F&B reputation is stellar. Welcome, Himanshu.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And finally, we come to Rushina Munshaw Gildial. She is a culinary expert, gastronomy writer, and corporate food consultant with over 15 years of experience in the Indian food industry. One of India's pioneering bloggers, she is an expert on a whole lot of things, including ingredients, cuisines, food history, and food stories. She pulls together the Godrej Food Trends Report each year and is currently working on her second book on Garhwali food. Welcome, Rushina.
Thanks so much for having me.
Okay, so Thomas, let me start by asking you about your food journey and especially into regional food.
So it's actually really interesting because my journey with cooking began at home in my grandmother's kitchen, but professionally, my background is all European, whether it's hotel management school in India or the Culinary Institute of America in New York. We always taught as chefs to learn Western techniques, the French brigade system, fancy imported ingredients. And you're taught that that's the pinnacle and that's the goal you kind of aspire to. And it took me a long time to come full circle, actually, because I just followed that path because I had nobody telling me any better. But it actually took a 4-month food trip through Europe. Yeah. Spent all my life savings. Whereas I'd actually gone to explore European food, but I had some major epiphanies on that trip that made me completely kind of almost ashamed that here I was spending all my time and energy trying to learn a Western cuisine when I'd done nothing to explore my own. So I think that trip in September of 2013 kind of changed my entire outlook towards food. And I came back with a renewed purpose, and that's around the same time that Chef Floyd, Samir and Yash were looking for an executive chef for a soon-to-open modern Indian restaurant. So it was almost serendipitous in that sense. And I think for me, after that, as soon as I got the job, again, with zero professional experience in Indian food, I realized I know nothing about Indian food. And I realized I needed to, the only way for me to learn was through traveling. So I did another trip just months after I came back from Europe. Went to about 18 or 19 different places across India, north, south, east, northwest, northeast, all of it. And what I saw on that trip again completely blew me away, because I was seeing ingredients and techniques and recipes and traditions which I'd never seen before. I'd never heard before after like 6 years of culinary education and like several years working in the industry. And they're all like super exciting, very unique. A lot of parallels with Western techniques and Western ingredients, but nobody was talking about any of this. And you definitely weren't seeing it in Indian restaurants. So for me, those two experiences coupled together is what kind of amplified my feelings towards changing my direction and philosophy around cooking. And I haven't looked back ever since.
That's a great and long journey. And I suppose, yeah, you start off thinking that you were going to be doing European and then deciding that, you know, your forte and your interest is in something else. But I'm sure nothing is wasted in these kind of...
Absolutely not. I mean, because I learned a lot through those, maybe I think 8 or 9 or 10 years. It's important to know, understand basic techniques and other cuisines as well. And I think it's sometimes you need to step away from what you have and then come back to it with a renewed sense of appreciation to really, you know, be able to do justice to it.
Absolutely. Himanshu, now we'd like to hear your story. So tell us how you came to be interested in regional food.
Yeah, so it all started back 1997, even before that. So I born in place Dehradun, where Rushina is right now. Oh. I grew up there, yes. And I'm actually from I'm a Punjabi, and you know, everybody is foodie in Punjabi, you know.
Absolutely.
Your relatives, your parents, everyone, you know. While having dinner, you plan for next day breakfast and lunch. I remember like Thomas said that he has learned, he's got inspired from his you know, grandparents, grandpa. So something similar with me as well. I remember the flavors of my grandmother. This is all where I started, because I remember in Dehradun, we had our house, and my grandmother was too stuck to make food on chula, because they had those small canopy which used to go on top, you know, that small baby hood, and then she used to lit fire and make the food. So I still remember the way she used to make the breakfast omelette and basic preparations like Punjabi, like a chole and all that stuff. I still remember those. And then gradually I had inclination towards, you know, the food side. I try to learn, you know, basic techniques from my mother. My taste buds were not very evolved, because we grew up there and we ate only Punjabi food, nothing else, because the world was very small in those days, in back in 90s. And this is where I went for the hotel management. And I went for the hotel management back in 1997 to Kerala, Thomas Place. I studied in Kerala in Trivandrum at the Kovala. Yeah. And that was like a completely a big shift. I just couldn't, you know, for 6 months, I just, very, very difficult for me to, you know, understand that food. Everything had a curry patta and the coconut. And then it was really, those days was really, really difficult. Yes. And which was, you end up evolving your taste buds and stuff. I mean, that's my favorite cuisine today. Somebody asked you, which is your favorite cuisine? I said, yeah, you know, Kerala food. I would eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So, but frankly, you know, it was started from there. And actually, then you know, I came to Mumbai. So I did explore. We used to go out in Kerala. We went to a lot of places. You know, you name the place, we've been there, Munnar, Kottayam. We did explore the Syrian Christian food. We did explore back in 90s. You know, we used to do for training, and I remember that hotel which used to very, very, you know, known, Taj Malabar, with under the very senior chef. So we did explore in Kochi. So a lot of Barkala and stuff. So we did know good understanding. We did have good understanding of Kerala food and came to Mumbai. Now it's been more than 20 years I've been in Mumbai. My actual journey started, my last assignment was St. Regis, Mumbai. This is where I moved into this corporate role close to almost 3 years back. This is where I started traveling. This is where I have learned the most local food, where I traveled in India. You know, because you go, you open the hotel, for example. This is where you go and explore. You do the competition check. You go out and eat food on, you know, streets. You learn their culture. You understand their history. This is where I have actually explored the most. And very frankly, I got married to a bonk. So now I've learned good. She's from Calcutta. My wife is from Calcutta. So that food is something which is very, very different. Bengali food. Yeah, so I learned Bengali food. That's you know, it's something, you know, she does cook Bengali food once or twice in a month at home, but so different it is. Yeah, very less usage of onions and tomatoes, and you know, bringing out the flavor, not only from fish, it's just some basic vegetables, like, you know, simple vegetables, you come up with some great, you know, flavors and textures. Well, so in last 3 years, I've really learned a lot while traveling, you know, different places of the country. So we opened a lot of hotels in last whatever 3 years in different locations in the country. So this is what my journey is about local, and then and you know, I love traveling, and every year we drive, you know, with family. So me, my wife, I have a son who's 11 years now. So we drive every year, and like Rushina just said, that every 100 kilometers the cuisine changes, and yeah, but she's right. Every house the cuisine, the, you know, the taste and the food changes. But yes, when you travel in India, like Thomas said, he had whatever 4 months travel in Europe. It's actually in India, the culture changes, the everything changes every 150, 200 kilometers, and so much of learning, there's a history to it. That's one. And now I'll tell you, when I started my career, I was a management trainee, and I was doing my specialization. This is where you know, when I know these 20 ingredients, I know what Iberico ham is, I know, you know, what Parma is. We get the best caviar from, you know, from Russia, or we do get best foie gras, truffle, and all those things. Yeah, we were high in life, and then we used to talk big ingredients and stuff. I remember, so we used to have an expat executive chef, and I was like 1.5-2 years old in the industry, and then there was a banquet event which was going on, and this is where we were running out of Indian breads. So I had to replace a guy the guy was not there to make Indian bread. This is where I had to fill in this position. And then I was making Indian bread for that event. I couldn't do the way the other guys were doing. This is where executive chef told me, buddy, you need to learn this. You learn your food first. Yeah. And this was the eye opener. You know, you first learn your roots first, you know, that will stay with you. So this was the eye opener back 20 years back. So since then, you know, I'm very passionate for local food. This is from my side, a little bit.
Lots of personal influences there as well as professional. So I think that is what makes it more interesting as well.
Right.
Okay. So Rushina, tell us about your journey into regional food.
So for me, the first sort of wake up moment, your eureka moment, that, you know, there was different kinds of regional foods in India, was when I got married. And, you know, my first few days here in Dehradun as a new bride, I remember, in fact, you know, it's a story I love to tell. I woke up in the morning on the first day after I got married, and there was this smell on the air, okay? And I had no idea what it was. It was a cold October morning, and here in the winter, smells just settle on the air. That's why you have that whole wood smoke association with the cold. Mm-hmm. So I'm like wondering, what is this smell, you know? And then I come down to the kitchen and I realize it's mustard oil that's being, you know, boiled, because we're making pakodis, which are the traditional festive pakoda that's made here for any happy occasion. Pakode batte hain. So birthday hoga, Diwali hogi, kuch bhi hogi. Chota dabbas of pakodas will be sort of sent out to all the relatives. So obviously for a wedding, this like this massive kadhai of mustard oil is boiling. Now I come from a Gujarati home where mustard oil was I'd never smelt it before. So that was like my seriously wake up moment ki, okay, the food that I grew up with is very different from the food in my husband's family. And it started from there, the journey, because over the next few days and then over the next few years, I discovered the similarities and yet the differences. You know, a lot of the ingredients are the same, but the way they're cooked are different. It's still dal bhat roti sabzi on the plate, but the dal bhat roti sabzi in my dadi's house and the dal bhat roti sabzi in my sasural are very different from each other. So then of course, just like every city person, I started looking for a cookbook because I wanted to cook all the food that my husband grew up eating, full romance happening and all.
Absolutely. In the beginning, when you get married, it is very strong, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Luckily for me, it stayed that way. But that's a conversation for a different panel. So there were no cookbooks available. And then I started talking. And, talking to the women in the family, writing down recipes, learning how to make stuff. And I think over the next 6-8 months, I started observing stuff. And then one day I cooked up a meal for my husband and his chachu, his uncle. And it was a simple meal of garwali, farar malka ki dal, aloo ki sabzi or kaddu ki sabzi, rice and roti. And roti, so I can't make, so I didn't even try, but rice and raita. And these guys literally started singing songs about the dal. It was basic arar malka ki dal. So it wasn't like I did any rocket science, but they were just, and they wiped out that kaddu. I didn't even get to taste it. So I was like, okay, maine kuch to idhar, I've managed to do something right. And then I wrote this essay on e-galette about garwali food. It's literally the first time garwali food was written about, and it's still there. And subsequently, now you see a lot of people have used that as a sort of a spin-off and done other work in that space. But that was the first time someone sat and tried to put a little bit of structure to what is garwali food. And it got a lot of people encouraging me. So at this time, just on the personal level, to put it in context, I was at home. I just had a baby by this time. The only conversation I had was with the baby, my husband, and the baby's caretaker who came home. So I was starved for conversation. And I had just moved back to Bombay, so I had no social connects, nothing. So ye baithe baithe ghar pe ye aise likhe e galet pe dala, and suddenly I had all these people telling me you should write a book about this and stuff like that. So my journey in food writing as well as discovering regional food started there. And then I came to Bombay and I ran into Antoine Lewis, who was at that time taking over as editor of Savvy Cookbook. And he offered me my first job. That was like major validation for me, okay? Because like at that point, I thought I was just a cow, honestly, to put it very, very simply, with a baby at home. And my mother reminded me of that all the time. But this was like great, because I was like, okay, grounding per se in journalism. I loved writing, but I wasn't formally trained as a journalist or in hospitality or anything. It was just curiosity. And I loved research. So those are the two things that I started working with. Over the next 15 years or so, I wrote a lot. I wrote for Femina, I wrote for Me Magazine in DNA. I wrote for almost 15 publications. And I must have done more than like 1,500, 2,000 articles, deep dives into all aspects of Indian food. And I don't think I've even scratched the surface, honestly speaking. Absolutely. It's still a journey of discovery. I mean, I've been doing the Spice Chronicles now using Instagram Live. And again, I feel like, every time you start on a new topic, researching, it's like we've got 100 shades of everything, whether it's dal or sabzi or spices.
It sort of just breaks off into more possibilities.
So I think I'm going to spend my whole life doing this, and I'm really not complaining about it.
Absolutely. I think what has happened already is I'm very hungry just listening to all of y'all, which is not the possible thing, because there's so much potential behind the words that you've said that tell you of food that has been eaten along the way. Anyway, let's move on. Thomas, the menu that you put together with the late and great Chef Floyd Cardoz at the Bombay Canteen celebrates, of course, the unexplored charms of different regions in India. And you sort of remake them into something familiar, but with a surprise twist. So what was the idea that you had when you were putting together these menus with Chef Cardoz? And I know the reception has been good, but were there iterations that you sort of made along the way?
So yeah, I mean, when Bombay Canteen opened in February 2015, it's not like we were the first regional Indian restaurant to open. We've always had regional Indian food represented, not in a very big way, but it was still there, both traditional and modern. But we wanted to see how we could tell the story differently, because we thought that Indian food could all be approachable and fun as well as exciting at the same time. For me personally, as a chef, I want people to be proud of our heritage, which you don't see as much as you should. I mean, if you go to any town in Italy, you'll see everyone's like holding on to their traditions so strongly, their culinary traditions more specifically. Chef Floyd's reputation obviously preceded him when we opened. He was an incredible chef, a great mentor, and people are really excited about what we were going to be doing. But we still got a lot of pushback, I think, in the beginning. People weren't entirely accepting of some of the things we did, like, say, for example, using Loki and Tenli on the menu, or doing tacos with tepla. You would have people say things like, "Why I can eat this at home, why would I pay money and come to a restaurant to eat this?" But I think for us, it was important. We had a vision. It was important for us to stick to that vision and that philosophy. And we just kept pushing the same message over and over again till people got it. And I think they finally did at some point. I don't think we made any major iterations. We just figured out fun, different ways to keep telling that story.
Yeah. And you made it, and how? I mean, that has been some success story. So that's really good. So I'm going to ask Himanshu now. You firmly believe that regional cuisines are not just about food, but actually about the representation of a culture of a region. So it's like a force that binds us all to our roots. And you feel that, you know, showcasing regional food is actually a way to tap into the emotion of that destination. So tell us a little about how you and how you come to think of this.
Okay, so before I answer this question, first I would like to second Thomas. So we always, we conduct the chef's workshop every year, executive chef workshop. So this is where I conducted this workshop back in 2016 early. Why I'm saying this, because this is all about local. 2016, I conducted this workshop. We conducted the workshop when I was the executive chef of JW Marriott Juhu. And this is where we had almost 30 executive chefs across India. And I took all of them to Bombay Canteen for the dinner. And we must have ordered 25 dishes. We were thoroughly thrilled. And you know what was the most interesting thing in this overall? We were really impressed, because that was like, for me, that was the first time we went to Bombay Canteen. And this is where I felt pride. You know, I'm taking to a restaurant who is so aligned with our thoughts. And everybody who was serving the food had story to tell about that particular dish. That was really, really impressive. So thank you, Thomas. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really, I still remember that.
What you must be feeling, because I got goosebumps when he said that. So that's
no,
great.
You're not.
Thank you. I mean, that means a lot to me.
It's a pride moment for me. You know, I'm taking those 30 executive chefs to a place where they had only one thing to say, you know, outstanding. So, yeah. Now answer to your question. First of all, local was a tagline before, which is not new anymore. Local is not a tagline now. Now it's a way forward in culinary, is what I would like to tell you. And we as a Marriott, now, this is something which I will tell you what exactly we are doing as a Marriott. So we have a philosophy. We have three big pillars in our food and beverage business. You know, marketing is one of the business. You know, the second, which is most important, is go local. So whichever vicinity you're in North India, you're in South India, you're in Indonesia, or maybe in Japan, or in Korea, or in Singapore. It is very important to have or to get your local food right. That's very, 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 very important. So now the things have even evolved. Now, for example, now local has now going beyond, and now people are exploring hyperlocal. I'll give you an example, like for example, like Gujarat. Gujarat has their own cuisine, like a Gujarati food. Of course, when you travel from Surat to, you know, Ahmedabad, there are change in dishes. You go to Rajasthan as their own cuisine. Where you travel from Marwar to Mewar, there is a difference in cuisine. Similar in all the other states, but every state has a cuisine. But there is no state for Sindhis. There's no state for Parsis. But still, they are so attached to their cuisine. They are so interlocked. They are so, you know, bounded with their cuisine. And this is what I would say. You know, hyperlocal is the new. Like for example, the cuisine which is getting evolved on the way of evolving is Coorg. Yeah. So that's another one which is coming. So there are a lot of emotions attached to it, and we as Marriott put a lot of effort to get the the local food right. And of course, you know, there are a lot of things attached to it. First of all, you get your local business right. That's one most important thing. Second, you drive the authenticity. When you have the local food, this is aligned with the sustainability. It's one of the biggest initiative we as a Marriott, doing. Suppose you have a local food, you would use 100% local ingredients. This is where you will reduce the carbon footprint instead of flying, you know, the stuff from European countries. Yeah, so that's another. And now I'll give you little examples. Like when we do our menu frameworks, when we give a direction that this is how your menu should look of your specialty restaurants, of your room service, of your coffee shop, or the buffets per se, you have to have 70% menu local. Yeah, or locally inspired. We are driving from upper property level that, of course, we can track the ingredients what are coming in the hotel. And this is where we are giving the scorecards. Minimum ingredients should be local or locally produced, which should be 90%. And then you get better rating when it goes up to 92 to 95%. Okay. I mean, yeah, so that's one. Now I'll give you a few more examples. We have a cassava. Cassava is a beautiful Kerala restaurant, Kerala cuisine we have in Marriott Kochi. And we have a chef who we have hired who has worked for 20 years in different standalone small restaurants and small dhabas. What do you call Tatkada? You call Thomas there in Kerala? Correct. Yeah. So I cannot pronounce that, but yes, that guy has actually worked in those areas and that we hired him. He's running a fabulous restaurant. He's got Syrian Christian thali. He's got a Muslim thali over there, which proper rituals are followed in that. I'll give you a beautiful example. I don't know whether you guys have been to W Goa. W is a very lifestyle brand where drinks and music is something, you know, is one of the biggest pillars for their brand. It's a very lifestyle brand. And this is where we are serving a Goan thali, and it works the most. This is where the style in the thali, that's very, you know, quirky style kind of presentation with a small, labaya pans and stuff. We do a nice, beautiful presentation, but what is there in the thali is a basic tindli, which is cooked with mustard and coconut. Those small courgettes. Yeah, there is a local fish curry. It is about creating the experience of people who would not even expect to get that kind of authentic regional food in W Goa. I'll give an example, like where Rushkina is at JW Masuri. This is where we do three different kind of thalis. One is called Pahadi Thali, where we showcase the Tehri food. I mean, JW brand, and then it's a luxury hotel where we push so much the local cuisine. There is a Kumauni Thali, and there is a Dev Bhumi Thali. And this is where, you know, all four dhams, what you call in North India, we have picked up the ritual, those dishes. And, the Dera, which is always known, that the Dera Doon is known because of that Dera ritual. So those things are there. Now I'll give one more example, like a Ritz-Carlton Bangalore. we have a beautiful restaurant, Indian restaurant called Rivaz. We have a Avadhi Thali in that restaurant. So yes, we as a Marriott drive Go Local as one of the biggest initiatives that's been going on from last 4-5 years and that we are going to continue, which is very much aligned with the sustainability. So this is from my side. Thank you.
Nice. Rushina, now we come to you, and you believe that you are a great expert on spices and ingredients, and you've run the series through the lockdown called The Spice Chronicles, right? And because you believe that local traditional ingredients can be kept alive by using them both in traditional recipes as well as new ways. So tell us about this campaign and how it has been received.
Just before that, I'd like to do my little bit of fangirling for both of these chefs we have here. You know, I think this is a food ecosystem. All of us have a passion for documenting and celebrating traditional food. And as somebody who watches food trends, I do the Godrej Food Trends Report. As somebody who writes a lot on food, I think hats off to both of you and the organizations that you guys work with, because I think some of us, we are geeks. I'm a food geek. I love learning about food, but you guys make it cool. You make Tendli and Loki and all of that stuff cool. So Thomas, just keep going with all of that. Yeah, even if people are like, why are you putting tiplas on your menu? And Himanshu, I have worked with the Masuri team, JW Masuri, the first Garhwali Thali. We did a Garhwali sojourn where we brought a whole bunch of people to JW Masuri, and we did an immersion to Garhwali food. And working with that team over there was so fun at that time. I might be going across to meet them again this time while I'm here.
So I'll let the chef know though. Yeah,
they know. I've been in touch with them. It's just that with the corona, we've not really made a plan yet. But they are doing great work. And the guy you've got there now, he's like seriously into...
Simran is the executive chef there. Simran is the executive chef.
And there's also a younger fellow who's been around. He was there when I did the Garhwali Thali also.
He's been there.
Yeah. So he's quite passionate. So it's fun to work with him.
Because he's
Garhwali. Of course. But you know, more than just the fact that you guys, what I appreciate about the Masuri team is they've gotten the local ladies. They're working with the local food producers. That is brilliant because job opportunities are happening. And there are many techniques that are part of the home kitchen that, you know, even if you guys are really... accomplished professional chefs, you won't be able to do, because these people have been doing it their whole lives. From that perspective, I think it's brilliant what you guys are doing, and I think I've taken up more airtime fangirling over here than saying my own bit.
Thank you so much, Sina.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
But I will also say, Prima, that I'm not an expert. I think what I'm very good at doing is telling the stories, bringing the conversations out. I'm a student. I think I'll be a student my whole life. And Spice Chronicles specifically is showing me that. So Spice Chronicles was basically my lockdown project. I shut my kitchen studio, which I ran for 7 years, in December of 2019. 2020 was supposed to be my year of, you know, because I believe that for all of us, we need to spend 80% of our time learning and 20% of our time talking about the stuff that we learn. If we don't have things to feed us, there's nothing we can talk. We'll be just repeating the same things again and again. And for a very long time, I hadn't had a chance to just deep dive into anything. So 2020 was supposed to be the year where I did my version of Chef on the Road and went off to, you know, on culinary adventures. तो वो तो लॉकडाउन की वजह से थोड़ा स्पैनर इन द वर्क्स सिचुएशन हो गया, एंड आई वाज वेरी फ्रस्ट्रेटेड टू बी वेरी ऑनेस्ट, बिकॉज़ आई वाज डीमोटिवेटेड. आई वांटेड टू मूव फॉरवर्ड, आई नीडेड समथिंग टू गेट गोइंग, एंड आई वाज सॉर्ट ऑफ स्टक एट होम. एंड देन आई डिस्कवर्ड दिस इंस्टाग्राम लाइव प्लेटफॉर्म व्हिच अलाउज यू टू हैव अ कन्वर्सेशन, एंड यू कैन हैव अ पब्लिक कन्वर्सेशन वेयर अदर पीपल कैन जॉइन इन. एंड अ फ्रेंड ऑफ माइन शुभ्रा, शी स्टार्टेड डूइंग हिस्ट्री ऑन अ प्लेट. yes. where she was discovering the history behind specific dishes. And then I thought about, you know, how I've always wanted to chronicle food, and wasn't there some way that I could perhaps chronicle some aspect of Indian food? And that's how Spice Chronicles was born. The idea was travel from the north. I started in Kashmir. I'm at about 95 odd episodes now. I've just finished with Karnataka, and I'm going to start Kerala. Thomas, can I call you? So I'm going to start Kerala soon. But the idea was to get into kitchens, talk to people, because we all know that we use spices, okay? But the real knowledge of how spices is used is in home kitchens, and it changes. Every kitchen uses it differently. So there's also the cook, I believe, is the most important ingredient in any food that is cooked. They bring a bit of themselves into what they're cooking. Now, that's one aspect. The other thing is, you know, with all these massive conversations about immunity boosting and everything that's happening just now, there's suddenly turmeric is into everything. And, you know, I realize that we have inherited a knowledge of how to do something, but not the why behind it. So a lot of, so the Spice Chronicles records oral testimonies of people in regional kitchens across the country. It could, and these are chefs, they're historians, they're food writers, they're journalists. The more main thing that each of them is a subject matter expert. And yeah. we focus only on the masala dabba, because the masala dabba is ubiquitous. Across the board, you will have a spice box in your kitchen in India, but the contents of it changes based on where you are. Yeah. And the other thing we focus on is spice blends. Now, that was the premise I started with. But where it's gone, it was supposed to be 30 episodes, okay? 29 episodes, one for each state and one episode to kind of round everything up. I'm still at 95. I've got half of India to go. Wow. Because I realize you can't cover it in one state. And one of the classic examples I'll give you is of Gujarat, which is my home state. I've grown up in a Gujarati kitchen. I think Gujarati food is the least documented, considering how foodie we are as a community, least documented of all the cuisines. And I have been lucky enough to know two variations, because my grandmother, my father's side was from Saurashtra, and my mother's side was from the Kachhi Bhatia community. And I have seen those two sides. So I knew that there was a difference, but it's never been written down anywhere. You wouldn't find it if you wanted to read about it. Mm-hmm. But through Spice Chronicles, this time I realized each of these states, if you kind of just look at them from a microclimatic perspective, the food changes. So the spices used change. There's also the influence of the borders that sort of, you know, I mean, of course, I don't think the political map of India is the framework one should use to study food, because it's relatively new. A lot of our food is based on our climatic conditions and the seasons. So like even Himanshu was talking about Parsi food. Now Parsi food in Gujarat is very different from Parsis that have settled in other parts of the country. The Kayast community is another example of that. Even the Sindhis of Rajasthan have a different kind of food from the Sindhis of Maharashtra. Hmm. So you see how many layers and nuances there are. Like you'll spend your whole life studying them, and that's where the geek in me is like super excited. And then you find out things along the way that you had no idea. Like for me, one of the biggest points of, fascination was dagad phool. Okay, the kalpasi flower, the stone flower. Until I started the Spice Chronicles, knew that it was part of Chettinad food. I knew that was part of some of the masala mixes in the western coast and south. But Madhya Pradesh actually uses a lot of it.
Okay.
So it's actually in their masala dabba, which means it's a daily use spice. Similarly with the spices in Uttarakhand, we use jakhia. It's our jeera / mustard. So, you know, these are the things that are coming out. And then also the nuances of, for example, bhang. It's a big thing. Everybody talks about, oh my God, you guys use bhang. Do you get like intoxicated by it? And I'm like, no, it's a different kind of bhang. And there's also two kinds of seeds which are often mixed up. So there's bhang jeera and there's bhang. Bhang jeera is perilla seed, Bhang is hemp seed. Both are used in different ways in the cooking. And I think I'm now geeking out on you guys as well. So you should stop.
No, but yeah, really, that's really interesting. And I think your statement about
I could keep listening to that.
So we'll do it after this then. Okay, so Chef Himanshu, you told us a lot about how each hotel has a specialty restaurant, and it's very important. Regional food from that area is really important. Do you also have like a cross showcase in different restaurants so that, say, in the north there are restaurants? What is the philosophy, you know, to sort of show different regional foods from the area that you, apart from the area that you are in?
Okay, so now. Like Rushina just mentioned about subject matter experts. So, because we have the bandwidth, we have hotels all across the country, or maybe let's say per se South Asia. This is where we have Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, and India. India is the biggest market. And then you name the state, we have a hotel, or we have a number of hotels, whether it be Rajasthan, Delhi, you know, North India. You know, we have in Jammu, Kashmir, you go to South India, in Kerala, Tamil Nadu. And we have subject matter experts. This is where we involve our subject matter experts, those chefs. It doesn't mean that person has to be on a very senior position. Somebody who's a line cook, but who understands the right flavors, the authenticity of the food. This is where we have a big, extensive list of subject matter experts, and we move these chefs for cross promotions. We move these chefs for training purposes, for opening hotel. Yeah. So this is something which works, you know, in our favor, because we have the bandwidth, number of hotels we have. Similar way now if we go internationally. For example, we have to do a local food promotion of Indonesia, let's say a Bali food. We can easily fly chef from Western or from Ritz-Carlton to this country, and then it works very well for us. So yeah. this is something which I would say, I'm sorry I've taken a lot of time on this. I was supposed to reply only on two lines. So yeah, this works for us the best. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Himanshu. So Thomas, we want to hear now, even she mentioned the chef on the road trips. I think every food enthusiast thinks that they are amazing. Are they actually as amazing as they seem? And are there any sort of not so great things that happen on these?
I'd be kidding if I said they weren't amazing. They are, in fact, as spectacular as they look. But I mean, it's not like it's just all rosy. These trips are typically hard because there's long hours on the road. You have to have a very big appetite. And I mean, ideally, I would like to just go on these trips and just enjoy the experience and eat. But here I'm researching, I'm documenting. So I'm approaching it through a different lens, which is not as fun. And there are obviously disappointments. Maybe something, a meal may not work out. Bad meals. I should actually start posting about the bad meals too. I mean,
it would make us feel a little better if you also did the fails. What do you say, Rushina?
But
I agree. I think that a lot of times things are hyped up a lot, and the actual experience doesn't meet the hype. Yeah. But I think there are also, you know, if you don't go looking, you won't find the jewels. So,
yeah. So, I mean, the one thing I do is if I have a bad experience, even if it's like the most popular restaurant in that area, and this happened many times, I'll just not talk about it.
Yeah.
It's not that I'll give a false impression of it. So,
yeah.
And I think, I mean, I put out so much content that it's already too much. But I mean, I count myself very lucky to be able to do that.
Yes, we think so too, that you are lucky. Okay, and now Rushina, quickly tell us about this new book on Garhwali food. You are already an expert, but you are now in it. So I'm sure you can just go out, rush to the market, get all the ingredients that otherwise you might probably have had to have sent to you and, you know, sort of stashed and kept and all that. Is that helping with the writing?
So first of all, it's not a new book. this book has been in the works since that first article I wrote on Egalit.
Wow.
What has changed is I've changed. So when I started writing it, I was writing it from a different perspective. But after 15 years of research, documentation, a lot of exposure of various things, my approach has changed. I believe now that there is a lot more to the, so the work I've already done has been great, but there is a deeper dive that I wanted to do. You know, I'll give you a very quick example to kind of sum it up. There is a dish called Nal Badi that we make in Garhwal. So we make badis all over the country. This Nal Badi is unique to Uttarakhand. It's basically made by putting the badi paste on a colocasia stem. It's a heirloom dish. It's disappearing now. You can get commercial Nal Badi. It's not the same as what is made at home. It's been a part of my pop-ups all these years. And Thomas, I might have sent it to you when I sent you Khana years ago.
Many years ago.
It is, yeah. So it's a delicious dish, okay? And I've talked about it and I've done the research and I've written about it in several places. It's still alive in our family because all the ladies make it. Now, this year I was here and I made it with my mom-in-law. And I learned the techniques. So there is a technique to putting it, the coating of that badi paste onto that colocasia stem. If it's not easy, if you get it wrong, it all falls off. So the consistency of the paste, the way you layer it onto the stem, watching it, letting it dry, making sure you cut it at the right time. So the once the stems are coated, they are then chopped up and dried in the sun. Now, nowadays you get commercial varieties where they just make a pulp of the paste and mix it with the dal paste and it's made like your regular buddies. The taste of the end product is very different. So that is what I've been able to do because previously I would come on trips of 10, 15 days, do a little bit of research and go back. But this time I've been here now for 2 months. I should hopefully be here for another 2 months if lockdown allows it. And it's giving you a chance to progress through the seasons also. So when we came in, you know, we were just at the end of summer, the pumpkins and the bhindi were still around. Now, if you see my garden, it's beautiful. We've got the pahadi palak and all the greens coming in. And every day we are cooking up something that's literally chopped up and brought into the kitchen in the morning. And I can go on and on about it, but I think I've gone past my two lines.
The two line thing is
I think that buddy sounds like a Sikh kebab. So there you have everyone who's been looking for a vegetarian Sikh. We have it right in front of us.
Yeah, you know, Thomas, that's exactly what I was thinking when I was watching mom put the paste onto the stem, that it's the same technique that understanding of the technique that you need for putting a Sikh onto the, a kebab onto the Sikh so it doesn't flop off.
Wow.
But Rushina, like you said, that jakhia, I still miss that jakhia. Yeah? It's like a between mustard and jeera for Garhwalis. Yeah.
Are bhej deti hu. Send it across. Send me address.
Sure.
Take advantage while I'm here if you need all this stuff.
Definitely, I will.
Okay, so now you guys, we've come to almost to the end. In one line now, one sentence. Are you optimistic about the future of regional food? Thomas.
I'm definitely optimistic. I think we've come a long way. We're in a much better place than we were, say, 6 years ago before Bombay opened. I think people like Rushina constantly pushing important information that's carefully researched out there. I think what Chef Himanshu said about the Marriott's initiative to focus on local is so heartwarming because it's a new way of thinking and it requires a lot of maturity and foresight to be able to make big decisions like that. But I think, let's not kid ourselves. This trend is only currently in the cities. The trend of moving away from appreciating our own cuisines is actually only right now kind of making its way in the smaller towns. And so, you have to take it with a pinch of salt, but I'm definitely optimistic.
Okay, Chef Himanshu.
optimistic. I am definitely optimistic, and I think this is the way forward for culinary. I think this is no more a trend, I would say now. This is something which will stay forever. And I think this will continue.
And I think your strategy in the hotels also gives it that much more weight. So that is really reassuring.
Yes.
And Rushina now.
You know, it's something I've been watching as part of the trends research that I've been doing. It's a movement that's been growing, and I'm calling it a movement. It's like Himanshu saying, it's no longer a trend. It's a regional food movement, and we are all part of it. We're all contributing in our own ways. And I think that is the beauty of it. A trend never happens in isolation. It happens because different levels or different verticals in the food industry are now talking about it. So JW Marriott is putting all its strength behind it. Thomas is putting all his strength behind it. I'm putting my strength. And there's a whole lot of other people out there. You know, we just did Indian Breads Day yesterday. Yes. And I started doing Indian Food Observance Days, I think 4 years or 5 years ago. And this time it was so exciting to see how people have shared things. Like yesterday we had somebody who shared a Chhattisgarhi bread I'd never seen in my life. So it's there, it's happening, and it's happening at all levels. And I think it's just going to get more and more exciting and amazing. We just have to be careful not to get too chaotic about it. That's one reservation I have.
So on that very positive note, we are going to now rush into our rapid fire round. We are following this order. Please remember, Rushina, Himanshu, Thomas. When you travel for food, you always look for?
I look for where the taxi drivers and the chefs go to eat after they go off duty.
Himanshu.
I mostly travel with my family. And I look for the culture and the history of the local food of that particular area or vicinity.
Thomas.
I look for home cooked meals. And if it's a home that'll let me enter the kitchen and learn from as well, perfect. And I'm increasingly luckier because every time I travel, I get to do that. So.
Wow. Okay. Now, the one Indian regional cuisine you're like ambivalent about, Rushina.
None. I think I want to explore them all. They all have their strengths. And I don't think anybody should be saying anything negative about any regional cuisine. They all have evolved because of a lot of history and influences.
Himanshu.
I second Rushina. I wouldn't say that. But yes, there are cuisines which are not very well explored. This is where people don't have enough knowledge about it. Yeah, they have their thoughts, like the cuisines which are still, you know, unexplored or because of the lack of tourism, people have not actually, you know, developed their palate. So they don't have enough knowledge about that particular cuisine. But I think every cuisine has their own identity, and we should not, or nobody should say anything about any
so
cuisine.
All those,
unless something you really know about that.
All those cuisines need a Rushina for them.
Thank you. That's a lot of hard work, though.
Okay, so like a Rushina. Thomas, you.
I agree with both of them, but on the other spectrum of cuisines that are underappreciated or lesser known, I think there's also cuisines which are like overly put out there and then obviously then bastardized to a point, like say Chef Himanshu's own cuisine of Punjabi food, right?
I was going to say the same thing.
Yeah, it's you get it in any Indian restaurant across the country. If you go to a restaurant in Kochi that serves Punjabi food, everyone's idea of it is like butter chicken, for example, which is not even Punjabi. Right. And even for the educated palate, Punjabi food means sarso ka saag. But there's so much more to it. So I think the perception, I'm ambivalent about the perceptions around Indian food.
Yeah, that's a good qualification. Now we are going to choose for each other. If there was one regional dish that you, Rushina, would like Thomas to try, what would it be?
I think I made him try a bunch of them. But you know, because I know you're coming to Uttarakhand next, right, for Chef on the Road, Kachmoli. And some, so Kachmoli is spit roasted goat, and it's cooked so that it's a festive tradition. It's made during weddings and stuff like that, and it's basically the whole goat is cooked on green twigs, so it's smoky, and the flesh is taken off with the crispiness, the crispy skin as well as the inside, and it's Kachmoli because it's medium rare kacha.
Wow! So then, I'm inviting myself to your house if you're gonna make Kachmoli for me.
I can't make Kachmoli, but maybe we can make it together, Thomas. You need an oven to do it in a home situation. Otherwise, let's you have to like put a whole pit together and all that. But it's then these pieces are taken off. They're mixed with mustard oil, turmeric, chili powder, and salt. And oh my God, I've had it only twice in my life because it's just such an this thing to make it. But
now you put it out there, we need to make it happen.
I've made it with a leg of ran at the studio. Like I've done it a more home style version. It's definitely something you should do. And because I know you'll bring a certain understanding to it, when you're traveling through, look for the non-vegetarian aspect. So Tons Valley, where Shubhra is, and areas over there, they do a lot of offal and smoked, and we have a blood sausage and everything. Not been documented, so maybe that you can add to your list.
Great.
So there's your project. Done. Have a joint project, I feel, in the next Okay, now we go to Himanshu. What do you recommend for Rushina?
So Rushina, I think I don't know whether you've tried or not. It's called Moshar Gongto. Okay, you've tried that one? No. So it's made with banana flour. So my wife does it very well. You know, you soak it in the salted water. You brine it a little before cooking it. There's no onions, there's no tomato, no fancy stuff. Very basic banana flour with panch puran and cooked with mustard oil. And then you finish it with coconut. A few people try to, you know, make it. So it's just dry preparation eaten with, you know, the rice. The rice what you get in West Bengal. It's a different rice preparation thing, and then it's really tasty, really really tasty.
Yeah. I've had it, but I'm happy to come over and eat your wife's version.
Yes,
there should be an invitation in that.
Yeah.
And now, Thomas, what do you choose for Himanshu?
I think I will choose something from his favorite cuisine, which is my native cuisine. So something from Kerala, which he probably may not have tasted. My grandmom used to make this, cook this vegetable called kurka, which is known as Chinese potatoes. It's a kind of tuber, which is tiny, very hard to clean, which I realized only years later. But it's got this lovely nutty flavor. And she makes something called kurka olatiyada, which is basically just stir fried with garlic, red chili, coconut oil, curry leaves. That's it. And I'd want Chef Himanshu to taste that.
So garlic, red chili, coconut oil, and
curry leaves.
He's going to try.
But it's the vegetable. It's the vegetable that comes through. It's the vegetable.
Got it. Simple.
Okay. And now for our absolute last part of the rapid fire. Please have fun. You have just the master of the food universe. Rushina, what's the first thing you do?
Make everyone have dal rice with ghee.
Dal rice with?
Ghee.
Wow, okay. And Himanshu?
I would drive lot of authenticity and culture to the new generation, for the kids. When they grow up, they ask for their roots, the food which has come from the roots, rather than, you know, fancy fish and chips and burgers.
Yeah. And Thomas?
My answer is very similar to Chef Himanshu's. My motto will be start 'em young. So I think getting kids into the kitchen, teaching them like their native cuisines. Like Rushina said, even being able to cook a simple dal chawal, and also I think change the curriculums of every culinary school and hotel management school in India to to focus on prioritizing Indian food more than Western cuisine.
Yep.
Get, so I'm going to just, because you guys have given these like mind-blowing answers, I think I want to just repeat. So I would like everybody to have dal, rice and ghee, but there was a, I was trying to be like not too long with what I was saying. I would like everybody to eat a meal of dal, rice and ghee, because it is, it will teach us all to appreciate our food. And in this lockdown, I think we've all learned that dal rice was our fallback. And even in that simple dal, rice, ghee meal, there is so much variation from Kashmir to Kerala, from the west to the northeast. Dal, the way it is cooked, the way it is eaten with rice, it is our, I think, binding universal meal. And to extend it a little bit, to take into what you guys have said, what Thomas and Himanshu are saying about the future generations, I've been working in that space and trying to teach kids. I think curriculum in every school, not just hospitality schools, yeah, for boys and girls, should include basic life skill of cooking with an onus on Indian food. So that our kids, because, you know, the most popular day in the 10-day curriculum I have for kids in kitchen, the kitchen, is the dal rice day. They watch their mothers cook dal rice every day, but somehow they're not allowed to cook it. They enjoy cooking. It's basic moong dal and rice we do, and we do like a stir fry of palak. And you should see them clean their plates up after that. So it's just about the messaging we're giving our kids.
So guys, just in that dal rice whole, the whole statement, I think for India, if we sat down and made people do different dals for a month, we might probably have, you know, different variations, differences that come from home to home, every 100 meters and of course, all the states. So I want to thank all three of you, Rishina, Himanshu, Thomas. It's been such an interesting, invigorating, and I think insightful discussion. Thank you so much. I know that the future of regional food is in very good hands, because there are people like you out there in the food world for India, and of course then pushing it on out into the world. Thank you very much, guys. That's been great. All the very best. Thanks.
Thank you. I just want to add a final line to this. I know we, the three of us, have been talking for the last 45 minutes or so, but I think it's editors and journalists like you, who in the last several years have given so much importance to this rise of indigenous cuisines and ingredients, that is enabling us to tell that story as well. So thank you.
Thank you. That's really nice. I've never thought of it. Thanks a lot, guys.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.